Second money move on the list is to adjust. The information that we gathered in step one gives us a list of to-dos, essentially, for step two. Now, it's important to recognize for everybody who is still staying at home that our spending is a whole lot different today than it was in January. Grocery sales are way up. So are home meal kits and perhaps not surprisingly, alcohol. Restaurant spending is way down. Spending on traditional entertainment is down, but streaming services are way up. Travel and transportation and other sorts of commuting are way down. Shopping overall is down. Even healthcare expenses, despite the fact that this is a healthcare crisis, have tapered off because elective procedures at doctors and dentists have largely been put on hold or canceled for a while. But what all of this means is that you are likely able to spend less month to month on some things until life gets back to normal. You are able to sock more money away. It's worth mentioning that the savings figures overall in this country have been really remarkable. Again, we're seeing a little bit of that show up in the survey results from tonight and in the information that Brett told me about how well many of the members of Redwood are doing. But the personal savings rate in this country, it's actually a statistic that is tracked month by month by the Federal Reserve. It's defined as the percentage of our discretionary income that we sock away. It doesn't include things like 401k contributions and HSA contributions. And in February, before this crisis really hit, the savings rate, the personal savings rate, which was at 6%, which is about where it's been hanging for the last few years. In March, it jumped to 13%. In April, it was 33%. Now, just to put that in perspective, the last time that we even came close to this number was in the mid-70s when we hit 17.5%. And of course, 33% is not sustainable. By May, we'd already fallen back by 10 percentage points. Now we're hanging out again in that 17% range. But I see opportunity in these numbers to continue to save a little bit more on a consistent basis. We have learned, thanks to COVID, what we really value and what we can live without. We have really surprised ourselves by cooking on a consistent basis, by going to the grocery store once a week or once every 2 weeks, which by necessity means that we are making lists and planning meals. We laid off the pricey gyms and started walking, and there is a great deal of savings to be had in maintaining some of these changes. There are also other savings that we may want to think about grabbing. In particular, I think everybody at this point should be looking at the number of subscriptions that are coming into our households. The average household now has 21 subscriptions. They cost us $240 a month, which is thousands a year. But because we've been spending so much time at home, we now know which of these we actually use and which ones we don't. And it's time to cancel the ones that we are not using. Now, of course, if you are struggling, if you have bills that you are simply unable to deal with right now, you may be wondering what solutions lie ahead as the preventative measures that were put forward in the CARES Act begin to lapse, and it remains unclear if the government is going to do anything to replace them. Here's the overarching advice, and it's my advice, but I know it's also your credit union's advice. If you've got bills that you can't pay, pick up the phone. I mean, these are the bottom line, that your mortgage under the CARES Act may still be suspended for under 12 months if it's fed for up to 12 months if it's federally backed, that student loan payments are now on pause through the end of the year. Again, those are federal student loans, not private student loans. But if you are having an issue, pick up the phone and talk to your credit union. I have heard Brett say so many times over the years, there is nothing that Redwood won't do to help members. So pick up the phone if you need it and ask for help.